little ceremony.
Morning, everyone. How are you? Ready? I see a few jerseys going on today. Excited about that. This is more exciting, though. Get the bass player over here. There we go. Come on over. All right. This is Aaron and Charity. Hopefully you know them. If not, you should. This is my niece, Avery May. How exciting. Well, so I'm going to move way over here. Let's get everybody to squeeze on up here. All right. Okay. Look at this support system. How awesome, huh? And the dress. Come on. That is a dress right there. Aaron, you pick that out?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I bet you do. All right, here, let's move this. Charity, you go ahead and step forward. There we go. All right, we got to have that baby in full view. That's important, right? Surprise, Bethany hasn't stole the baby yet. Well, this is Avery May Aaron Harris, born April 10th of this year. And, man, is she a blessing. She is such a blessing. She is so sweet. So when we do a baby dedication, what we're really saying is the parents are saying we want to stand before our church family and let everyone know we are dedicating our child to the Lord. We are committed to raising our child in the ways of the Lord and asking really for us as a church to gather around them, to commit to being in prayer for them, and really asking God to just put His hand upon her life in this moment. We know there will come a day where she will have an opportunity to choose Jesus for herself. So she's not quite there yet. She's going to learn. She's got to learn how to talk and all that, those things too. But they are really standing up here saying, look, we're going to raise our child in the ways of the Lord and give her the opportunity to know Jesus and choose Him for herself. So I asked the parents, tell me about your child, and they told me some things. So they said Avery May is a sweet-spirited girl, flexible and easygoing nature, compassionate, but a force to be reckoned with. That must be at about 3 a.m. Okay, especially when it comes to the things of God, though. That's what they believe for her. Avery May is a symbol of God's faithfulness, love, and compassion for Charity and Aaron. She's our rainbow baby, our true miracle. Our hope for our daughter is that she will love Christ and His ways with fierceness. May she choose not to compromise His gifts and life for her for the things of this world. May she understand her purpose and passions for life are God breathed, and may she understand the importance of always keeping God the center of her life, no matter what. And they're believing for a spiritual gift of discernment, evangelism, and prophesying. And in Proverbs 31, 25 through 27 is what they are believing for their daughter. Avery means wise counselor and heaven sent, which, yes, and May means gift of God. This is a heaven sent gift of God. Aaron is spelled A-R-Y-N. It means enlightened or bringer of light. And I really, when you put that together, this heaven-sent gift from God who is going to be a wise counselor and someone who is able to bring light to others. And I just love the rich meaning and the heritage that God has given you for her already. As I was praying for her this week, really the word that God kept bringing to mind is reconciler. And 2 Corinthians chapter 5. It says that, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old is gone, and the new is here. All this is from God, who has reconciled us to Himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to Himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. And I just saw this picture of her as an ambassador for reconciliation, that there is this ministry of reconciliation and that she would be Christ's ambassador in that ministry. I don't believe it will be in an aggressive way, but in a sweet, spirited way. And by example, that I believe that God's going to put a compassion in her heart, and by her example, God's love will shine through her. And so we want to pray over her, but I know that Bethany wanted to share as well this morning, and so I'll turn the mic over to her.
Try not to cry.
Good luck.
This baby, you guys, speaks of God's faithfulness. Like, every time we look at her, we just can't help but say, God, you are so faithful. And I've known Charity for a long time and watched God do what he's done in her life, and just so grateful that Aaron has come along and become a part of that plan and destiny that God has. And here's this baby, and I get to play with her like every week and babysit her while her mommy and daddy work. And the Lord has just been showing me in that time that I've had with her that she's going to have a quiet strength. And it's amazing the peace that she already has as this young infant. And God has just reminded me, and I'm going to remind her parents, that every single time you hold her and speak to her and love on her, that there's an intentionality behind it. And I'm committed when I'm loving on her that it's intentional, and I'm speaking the good things of God over her. And the other thing was to sing over her. And I've just been singing over her, and I know you guys are and have been and will. But this morning when we sang this song, I was crying back there. I was not on Facebook. If anybody saw me on my phone, I was trying to find these lyrics. But I just want to say to Avery May, you are heaven-spun creation, his pride and adoration. You are a treasure woven by his love. His careful hands, they hold you safe within his promise of calling and of destiny. And to Aaron and Charity to say, you guys will sing of all he's done. You'll remember how far he's carried you from beginning to the end. He is faithful. He is faithful to the end. And that is the song that I just thought just brought this all together today. And I adore this baby. I adore this baby. I adore her mom and dad and her sisters. And I just can't wait to watch her grow up and get to know Jesus and to be a part of that. Yes, right? We're going to have so much fun.
All right, would you stretch out your hands as we pray this morning?
Lord God, you are so good. God, you are so faithful, and we thank you for this child that you have lovingly placed within this family, Lord. God, look at all these people, God, that you have brought together and that you have created a new family with, Lord, and this little one is just in the center of all of that, Jesus. And God, we thank you for her life. God, we thank you that you carried her all the way through the pregnancy, all the way to life, Lord, and that you have such promises for her, God, and such good things for her life to come, Father. I pray that you would just guide and direct her path, God. I pray for Aaron and Charity that they would just intentionally raise her in the ways of you. God, give them the strength, give them the wisdom, Lord, that it would be supernatural wisdom and insight into her little mind and her little heart. God, that they would know exactly how to parent her. God, if there ever comes a time to discipline her, to do all those things, God, that you're going to equip them, Lord Jesus. And I just thank you, God, that we get to be a part, that we get to just stand by and even watch this miracle story. Thank you, Lord.
We come together as a church, and I just pray for just an anointing upon her life even now, Lord God. And we've set her apart for you. I just thank you that you have great things in store for her. And we pray that just as a church, that we would be always mindful that we are with these two, that we are with this family, Lord, and that we stand with them, Lord. And so we commit to them today that we will pray with them, that we will walk this life with them. And we will be by their side, and we thank you for the life of Avery May and the blessing that she is, Lord God. I pray that that she would just soar, Lord. And we just thank you for her, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right. All right. Did we get our 6th through 8th grade that wants to go out? Go to class. Can we get that? Anyone else that didn't make your way out, feel free to do so. You can go. You can stay. I won't be offended by that. I won't be offended if you go. See, there goes my kid right there leaving. Here's enough of me all throughout the week. Oh my goodness. Anybody like math? Yeah, a few people. I got to tell you, I was pretty good at math. I was really good at math. I got A's in math when I was in school. It was a few years ago, but I figured it out. I don't know math now. I can't help my kids with their fifth grade and fourth grade math, but I was really good at math when I was in middle school and in high school. Algebra just made so much sense to me. Like, figuring out what X was like no big deal whatsoever. And then I hit geometry. Oh, my goodness. I don't know what it is. Like, I'm a very concrete thinker, and so theorems and postulates and, like, all this kind of stuff. I was, seriously, straight A's, always in math. I get to geometry, and all of a sudden, a square is a rectangle, but a rectangle is not a square, and my mind is like, what is happening? I don't understand how this works. True story, I went to the teacher's classroom every day after school for help and barely squeaked out a B minus in geometry. I just couldn't get it. It was like too abstract for me. It was just, I wish, Darren, you could have been there to help me, because I know you could have figured it out. Man, I'll tell you what, it was just one of those things that was just very abstract. And I don't know if you can relate, but some of you are really good at abstract thinking. I wasn't one of those people. And it just tripped me up. And I was thinking about geometry this week as I was, well, there's a triangle on the screen, and I'm sure there's a name for that triangle. You know, is that like a equilateral thing? We have educators in the room. Thank you for that. So, you know, there's this idea in Scripture about God. And as we think about God sometimes, it's really, I think it's natural. It's easy for me, just as I've lived life with God for many years, to really think about Jesus and what he's done. And we sing about his faithfulness. And we know about his sacrifice that he made for us. And we know that God created the earth, and we know who he is in a sense, but then I really started to think about, who is God really? What's his name, and is he the Father? We talk about the Father, we talk about Jesus the Son, and we talk about the Holy Spirit, and then all of a sudden, it does that geometry thing to my brain sometimes. Do you ever have that issue where you're trying to really think about God and who he really is, and you just think, wait, is he the Father? Is he the Son? Wait, is he one God? Is he three gods? Does God have multiple personality disorder? What's going on here? Trying to figure out who God is, and how can I understand him fully? And so when I hear the word Trinity, those things come to mind. How can I fully comprehend the Trinity? Or maybe I don't need to fully comprehend it, because for me, I want to worship a God who I can't fully comprehend. If I can fully comprehend him, then is he worth worshiping, right? I love that I can't fully comprehend God. In fact, I would say the more that I know God and the more that I learn about God, I feel like the less I know as I draw closer to him, because he is infinite. And there's so many layers there. And so we're going to just look for a few weeks here about this idea of Trinity. And this series is just simply called 3-in-1. And I use that because the word Trinity itself actually isn't in Scripture. And maybe you've discovered that. Maybe you've had a friend ask you, like, can you explain the Trinity? And you say, sure, I'll go look up some verses for you. But then you realize there weren't any. Like, the idea, this word Trinity is not in Scripture. The actual word we see in the Scripture is the word Godhead. But the concept is all over in Scripture. And that's what I want us to look at here. And we're going to get into just kind of some overview of what the Trinity is. And then we're going to look at the part of the Father this week. We're going to look at the Son, Jesus, next week, and then the Holy Spirit the week after that. And just because I really believe that God wants to build a foundation within each of us, that we can not just understand who God is, because I think that is somewhat of an impossible quest, but it's a quest I'm willing to attempt. But really what I want us to know is, what is the purpose of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? Like, next week, as we look at the Son, you know, we think about Jesus and when he came to earth, but we know that he was eternal. So what about Jesus, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever? And what is his purpose in all of eternity? And so beginning to look at really the bigger concept here, and my hope is that you would be, that you would know who God is and that it would affect your life in a great way. And so we're going to look at this 3-in-1 concept here. And the thing about the Trinity, as confusing as it is, and there's lots of pictures, and we'll get into that in a moment of what that could look like, but it's a confusing concept. And in fact, the most direct scripture in the Bible on the Trinity is omitted from many of our modern translations. Did you know that? The most direct scripture. So if you want to know why it's omitted, I don't want to get into a huge like sidebar on why that is, but I've done a lot of studying on this. But a lot of your translations, so if you read like the NIV or the NLT, you'll find that this whole scripture isn't in your version of the Bible. And it has a little bit to do with the different original texts that they were translated from, but you can talk to me about that later. The verse is 1 John 5:7. It says, "For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, who is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one." Very direct scripture on God being three and one simultaneously. Now, there's lots of scriptural sources that show us the mystery of the Trinity, and I'm going to name a few. They're not all going to be up here. Now, if you're using YouVersion, if you have the YouVersion Bible app on your phone and you want to go to the Events tab, all of these scriptures are listed there. If you want to follow along with my notes on there, you can. I just put the references up here, and you can do your own study later. And I just sampled a few of them. There's a lot more in the Bible, but I'm going to just give you a few here. The first one that I found in the Bible is actually in Genesis chapter 1, and if you don't know, that is the very first book and first verse of the Bible actually talks about the Trinity. You may have not known this, but it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters." And then in verse 3 it says, "And God said, let there be light." Well, the word God here in Genesis chapter 1 is the word Elohim, which is actually talking about God. It is both a singular and a plural word simultaneously. Now, in the English language, we don't really have words that are singular and plural at the same time. Well, I guess we do. If you can have present tense and past tense, like read and read and things like that. But this is singular and plural at the same time. And we see the in the beginning, God. And then we see the Spirit of God was hovering. So we see the Holy Spirit present right there in Genesis chapter 1. And then it says, "And God said," and that is the Word of God, who is represented by Jesus. And so you see in the first three verses of the Bible, you see present the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit as you begin to dig into this. It says in Genesis 1:26, "Then God said," singular now, "God," singular, "let us," plural, "make mankind in our image." So you have a singular God referring to himself as our. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, it says, "You shall have no other gods before me," saying there is one God. Again, in Deuteronomy 6:4, "The Lord our God, the Lord is one." And Jesus repeated that in Mark 12:29. And so this concept is there is one God and only one God. Isaiah 43:10 says, "Before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me." So this idea that Jesus came into the world and became another God, or the Holy Spirit came and was another God, the Scripture very clearly states there is only one God, and yet we see three parts of God all operating together. Welcome to geometry. Hopefully you're feeling good by now. In Exodus 3:14, God called himself I Am. In John 8:58, Jesus called himself I Am, and they wanted to kill him for it because he was claiming to be God. And then the big one that we see in Luke 3:22 is that the Holy Spirit descended on him, speaking of Jesus, in bodily form like a dove, and the voice from heaven came, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased." And it's an interesting part in Scripture because we know God is one because the Scripture has told us, and yet we see all three parts of God interacting at the baptism of Jesus. Now, this can be confusing. We can see clearly in Scripture that God is three in one, but it doesn't make it any easier to comprehend. Now, you may have tried to draw parallels, and if anyone heard parallels or examples of how to understand the Trinity, can we just admit that they are all terrible and lame? They really are. Right? Like, oh, it's like God's like water. It's like ice, and then water, regular temperature water, and then he's steam. All right, well, God doesn't have like a temperature regulation disorder, right? It's like that's not really like who God is. It tries to make sense, or people say, well, he's like the egg, you know, the shell and the white and the yolk. And really, those Like, we're trying our hardest as humans with our brains to try to get some picture of something that might make a little bit of sense to understand the nature of God. But the truth is, nothing comes close to comprehending how God is simultaneously three in one. I want to read you an excerpt from a book by C.S. Lewis. It's called Mere Christianity. And this is the closest that I've come to being able to slightly comprehend who God is. And he talks about the Trinity in the sense of three dimensions. And so you have different dimensions. If you were in a one-dimensional world, for example, you could draw, it would be either left or right. That's a dimension, right? You can only go left or right. If you add a second dimension, now you can go up or down. And if you add a third dimension, now I can go back and forward. Does that make sense? Okay, so here's what he says. If you are using only one dimension, you could draw a straight line. If you're using two dimensions, now you can draw a square. And a square is made up of four straight lines, two dimensions. Now a step further. If you have three dimensions, then you can build what we call a solid body, say a cube, like a dice or a cube of sugar. And a cube is made up of six squares. Now, the Christian account of God involves just the same principle. The human level is a simple and rather empty level. On the human level, one person is one being. Can we agree on that? One person is one being, okay? That's what we understand. That's like the one dimension. And any two persons are two separate beings, just as in two dimensions, like on a flat sheet of paper, one square is one figure, and two squares are two figures. But on the divine level, he says, you find personalities, but up there you find them combined in new ways, which we who do not live on that level cannot imagine. In God's dimension, so to speak, you find a being who is three persons while remaining one being, just as a cube is six squares while remaining one cube. Of course, we cannot fully conceive of being like that because God is on a different dimension than we are. All we can do is try to draw a lame little picture to help us understand. He goes on to say, you may ask, if we cannot imagine a three-personal being, what is the good of talking about him? Well, there isn't any good in talking about him, he says. The thing that matters is being actually drawn into that three-personal life, and you may begin any time today, if you like. And I love that he ends with that you, what is the point of trying to understand it if you can't comprehend it? And he says there's not a point unless you do something about it with your life and allow God to draw you into himself. And that's my invitation to you today, is to be drawn into the fullness of life of God, because he is a personal God. And so today is, and maybe that didn't help you whatsoever, but I want you to understand that my hope for you as we explore this over the next 3 weeks is that you would be drawn into the life of the Father, that you'd be drawn into the life of the Son, that you'd be drawn into the life of the Holy Spirit, and that you would find that he would impact your life in such meaningful ways, even in ways that you don't comprehend, but in ways that make a profound difference on the way in which you live your life. Because once you've stepped into the fullness of God in your life, everything changes. Have you experienced this? Has anyone experienced this in your life? We get an amen for that this morning. So let's talk about the Father. He is a relational God. And the picture of a father in Scripture is a relational God who wants us, who desires us, who is with us, and who is for us. And as we look throughout Scripture and throughout history, what we find is that God has increasingly made himself known to us throughout Scripture. I just talked to you about Genesis 1:1, where it says, in the beginning, God. Well, the word God there, I said, was Elohim, and that means supreme being. So in the beginning, there was a supreme being, it says in Scripture. But you see, what happens is when God creates man, and we move forward a couple chapters in Genesis, the word God now changes to the word Jehovah Elohim, which means he is a covenant-making God. So God goes from he is a supreme being to now introduce mankind onto the earth, and God says, I'm going to reveal to you another aspect of who I am. I am a covenant-making God. I have a personhood to me. And as we go throughout the Old Testament Scripture, and has anyone ever studied the names of God, looked at some of these names of God, or have noticed that the Bible references God in many different names? Well, what we'll find throughout Scripture, as Scripture goes on, we have more and more layers of God revealed. He has more and more of himself revealed. And so, first thing you see in Scripture is he's Elohim, the Supreme One, and then he becomes the covenant-making God. And then the next concept that we see is that he's El Shaddai, he's the all-sufficient one. And then he's El Roy, the God who sees. And then he becomes Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. Jehovah Rapha, the God my healer. Jehovah Shalom, God my peace. Jehovah Rohi, God my shepherd. And it keeps going and going and going as we see, as Scripture progresses, as we walk through life in the Old Testament with the Israelites, that God is continuously saying, I'm going to show you more of myself. I'm going to show you another piece. I'm not just your healer. I'm your shepherd. I am not just your provider. I am your peace. And he reveals himself to his people more and more as time goes on. And Jesus comes on the scene now in the New Testament as God steps somehow out of himself onto this earth in the form of Jesus Christ, which we will see next week that Jesus, by the way, is present also in the Old Testament throughout all of eternity. But he steps onto this earth in bodily form, and he begins to reveal now more of God. And he begins to reveal God as our Father. And we see God in the Old Testament as the Father of a nation, the Father of Israel, but God gets more and more personal the more you know him. Have you discovered this in your life? The more you know God, the more personal he gets. And so he says in Matthew 5:16, he teaches that God is our Father in heaven. Now, you may think when you read the Scripture that Jesus simply said that God is his Father, but he didn't just go that far. He told the people God is our Father. In fact, when he taught them to pray in Matthew 6, he said, start your prayer like this, our Father who art in heaven. Our Father. He's saying when you pray, it's a relational connection with God. And he brings us into this relational aspect, whereas in the Old Testament, there was a fear of God. There was this understanding that he was a supreme God. They knew that he took care of them. But he said, I'm going to bring you into the interpersonal life of the Father. And in Mark 14, he ups the game again and he says, he's not just Father, he's Abba, Father. So who is this Father and what does this mean to us? The Greek word here that Jesus uses for Father is the word pater. And it means a nourisher, a protector, and an upholder. Really, the basic role of a father, can we agree that a father should be doing those things? Now, you may have lived a life in which your father didn't do those things. You may have had the situation where your example of an earthly father wasn't what God the Father is, a nourisher, a protector, and an upholder. But God is our picture of Father. Whether we have a father here on this earth who is present, whether we have a father who has passed away, whether we've never known our father, we have God, our Father, to be the ultimate, the nourisher, the protector, and the upholder. But then this word Abba comes in, and it's the word Daddy. And it infers a close personal relationship and trust. It's the God that we see in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. It's the God that we see where it says that he walked with them and he talked with them. He's not just this God who brings home the paycheck. He's not just this Father who is there to make sure that the roof gets repaired when it falls apart. It's not just that kind of protector God. It's that personal God who is a trust God. You can trust him. You can have relationship with him. You can go to him. And it's important to understand as we look at the aspect of the Father within the context of the Trinity is that God created us from the perspective of relationship. Did you know that before mankind was created, God had a relationship already with himself? Before the angels were created, God had relationship with himself. He had relationship, interpersonal relationship within the Holy Spirit. Now, you can't really model that in your own life. Like, you can have relationship with yourself, I guess, but it's a little more awkward and weird than it is if God has relationship with himself. Like, God can talk to himself, and it's normal because there's three of him simultaneously. Well, there's one of him. If you just walk around talking to yourself, people will cross on the other side of the street, is how that works. Okay? It's not quite the same. But before you were formed, there was the Trinity who had relationship with himself, and you were created out of that relationship. So God has always been an interpersonal God, and he intended, as he created mankind, that we live in relationship. That is the context that God created us, because he made us in his image. He made us in his image. And so throughout history, despite the failures of mankind, and there have been many, have you seen that there has been failures of mankind? Have you noticed this? If you haven't seen any failures of mankind throughout history, I'll just give you one simple assignment. Go home, look in the mirror, and you can find a few. And if you get beyond that, then you'll see, if you begin to look around, you'll see that there's many others. I don't have problems finding failures. It's called I-5. That's all I need. And I see failures of mankind. It's quite simple. And we see that this is a reality of life. But despite failures, God pursues. Despite our failures, God pursues. And I look at the Old Testament. And do you ever read the Old Testament and you look at the Israelites and you just think to yourself, how can they be so thick-headed? You ever thought this? How could they be so dumb? God just told them not to do this, and then they did it again. The difference is that I think we're missing as we read the Old Testament is from one chapter to the next, it could be 30, 40 years difference. So, how could they possibly, God just told them in chapter 4 not to do this, and in chapter 5, how come they're already doing this again? How dumb can they be? But let's give them the benefit of the doubt. That might have been 20 years difference between chapter 4 and 5. It only takes us 2 days to mess up, right? It doesn't take us 20 years, 2 days. And we're making those same mistakes. So we've got to understand that God, as we look through the Old Testament, He just continues to pursue. We see things like it says that they did these things and God was ready to just wipe them off the face of the earth. But then it says, but then God heard their prayers and He had mercy upon them. And God heard their prayers and His grace was poured out upon them. Oh, aren't you thankful for the grace of God in your life? That He would hear your prayers, that He hears the prayers. I love the verse that says the prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective. But did you know that also the prayers of those who aren't feeling real righteous, who aren't feeling real holy, who aren't feeling real perfect, who have made lots of mistakes today, did you know that those prayers still hit the ears of God? Because your righteousness isn't dependent upon what you did today. It's dependent upon what Jesus Christ did at the cross. Aren't you thankful for that this morning? Right? So the next time you think to yourself, well, I can't pray because I can't be righteous, I want you to remember who owns your life in eternity. Because Jesus Christ has come and He has made you righteous. And so we see God, the ultimate reconciler, who sent a part of Himself, Jesus, into this world so that we could be restored to the Father and see His heart. And I love this ministry of Jesus because He revealed the heart of God to us. And He tells some parables. And in Luke chapter 15, He tells one of my favorite parables. And you may have heard this in parable. And if you haven't, you'll hear a part of it today. I'm going to read just a little bit of it in Luke chapter 15. In Luke chapter 15, Jesus tells a story about a young man who has made some decisions to go off into the world and do his own thing. Maybe you've made that same mistake, or you know someone else who has, who says, you know what, mom and dad, I am now smarter than you. I know more than you. I have lived a full 18 years of my life, and I know what I need to know. And so therefore, you can just leave me alone because I got this, right? And there's a part of each of us that needs to discover like those places of our life. And I know that it pains a parent's heart because you're just thinking like, I made all these same mistakes. Can't you just learn from me? The answer for some is no. They prefer their own personal pain. Like, that's how it seems to work in life. But what happens is you see this story in Luke 15 of this son who says to his dad, he says, you know, dad, I don't really need you. I know you provide for me. I know you take care of me. But I don't really want to wait till you die to get all of my inheritance. I'll just go ahead and take that now. Thank you very much. Because I got this figured out. And so he goes out and he does really like, this isn't any major plot twist. He completely blows it and messes it all up. Right? He goes to Vegas. He gambles it all. And he's winning. He's up $300. But then he's like, now I'm going to bet big because I can win. But now he's in the hole $300. And he digs himself a hole and says, now I'm going to win this back. I am certain of it. And I want to just tell you this morning some practical life wisdom. Casinos are huge for a reason. Because money stays there. Like, that's how that whole thing works. Okay? So maybe you didn't know that. Like, how do these guys stay in business? They take your money. That's how it works. All right? So it's not a great get-rich scheme. But this guy goes and it says he gambles away his inheritance. And he finds himself feeding pigs and thinking to himself, you know, that pig food really looks good right now. Now, if you were in that place of life where the pig food looks really good to you, you know you've hit rock bottom. And you know you've made a terrible mistake. And so he says to himself, maybe if I go back to my father, he'll let me just be a servant. He'll let me be a hired hand and work for him. I've already taken up my inheritance. I deserve nothing. And it says this, Luke 15, verse 17. It says, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him, and he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be your son. Now look, you've probably had a bad day too, just like this guy, and you felt the same thing. But this is what God does to respond to us in those places, and this is the story that Jesus gave to illustrate it. The father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. And in that moment, the father restored his inheritance. He restored his dignity. He clothed him again. And we see this beautiful picture of the father heart of God, who not only feels this way about the person next to you in your life, or the person that you know that God redeemed them and you think, wow, good for them, but God feels this way about you too. That in our deepest failures, God still loves us. And just like the son, even when we are consumed with our failure, God chooses to consume us with his embrace. That is the God that we serve. And if you get nothing else out of this message today, I hope you write that down and that you memorize it, that the God of the universe, when we are consumed with our failure, when we are consumed with our mistakes, when we are consumed with those things that we haven't done right, God, the Father, chooses to consume us with his embrace. That is the Father heart of God, as Jesus illustrated it. His heart is for you. He pursues you. You know that God forgives you, he restores you, and he wants you to know him. The God of the universe, our Father, wants you to know him. Jesus said he is your Father, and he wants to draw close to you. You know, church, there's a difference between growing and knowing. We know that growing in the Lord is important. In fact, we just spent the summer talking about taking the leap of faith and growing in our faith. It's important to grow. Would you agree with that? Growing in the Lord? It's important to grow up in the Lord. You want to grow up. You don't just want to grow old. Have you ever met someone who's like, they should have grown up by now, but like the fits they throw are still like they're three? And you don't really want to hang around that person when they're in that moment of life. In our Christian walk, we've got to grow up too. We need to be growing in the Lord. And I think that's an important thing, but here's what we've got to really understand about the Father of God. It's important to grow in him, but we must never lose sight of what's most important, and that's to know him. That is the most important thing, to know God, to spend time with him. And I have had to learn, I'll tell you what, I am a doer. Do we have any other doers in the room that just, you got to get things done? Like, my way of relaxing is to do something. I relax by working. That's messed up, quite frankly, but that's just like, I'm a doer. So it's like, day off, yay, how do I Sabbath, you know, yard project? Like, that makes no sense. But it's just, it's a way that I come down, and so, but here's what I got to know. I can get hung up on the disciplines of being a Christian. I can get hung up whether or not I'm successful at the disciplines of being a Christian. Anyone else get hung up on that? Now, it's important to do those things. It's important. But what if, I wonder, what if instead of trying to check the box in my life that says, all right, today, prayer, check. All right, today, did I read my Bible? Check. And I'm checking boxes to decide whether or not I'm successful as a Christian today. Now, don't get me wrong, do those things, but motivation is what matters. You see, what if instead of trying to check a box as a Christian discipline, what if we begin to do those things in pursuit of relationship with the Father of God? What if we begin to pursue the Father? You see, if we're pursuing a relationship, it shouldn't be hard to find time to pray. Really, it shouldn't. If we're pursuing relationship, it shouldn't be hard to find time to be in his Word, to learn about who he is. Why? Because you pursue what you desire. You pursue what you desire. Isn't this true? Like, if you have got a hankering for chocolate cake, you are going to pursue that chocolate cake. If you go to the first store and they're out of chocolate cake, you will go to the next one because you have got to have that chocolate cake today. I know it's close to lunchtime and I'm talking about food. Please forgive me, I have sinned. You pursue what you desire. Think about relationships in your life. You know, if you were to pursue a discipline, if you were to pursue change on the outside, has anyone got some things on the outside of your life that you're thinking that could change? Like, just be honest, right? Okay, raise the hand if the person next to you has something on the outside of their life. Okay. No, and he was talking about the person to his left, not to his right, just to be clear. Just for marriages out there, I was just making sure we're good. If you pursue outside change, you're going to pursue discipline, right? You're thinking, okay, I've got to get better at self-control. I've got to figure out that, like, everything that comes into my head doesn't have to be said. That's a good thing to work on. But see, if you desire to know God, you're going to pursue Him any way you can, not just with external change. See, if you've ever dated someone or even just met a new friend that you really liked and you wanted to get to know them, what happens? Think back. Maybe you can think back. Some of you have been in a marriage relationship for a really long time, and that's a good thing. But you've been in these places where I want you to think back about when you were pursuing one another. Or maybe you're not married. Maybe it was just a really good friend, and you were trying to learn about this friend of yours. Think about that time when you were building a relationship. Was it hard to find time to be with that person, yes or no? No, you just made that time, didn't you? You, like, would drop everything. In fact, there was other people in your life going, you never hang out with us anymore, right? Because you were figuring out a way to spend time with that person. Was it hard to pick up the phone and call, slash high school today, text, right? No, you just did it. Like, I remember when I was dating my wife, like, it's the dumbest thing. Like, we were on before text, right? Now you could just text someone and let some time go by and text back. We would be on the phone, and then you just sit there, and no one's talking after a while. Did anyone ever do this? You're on the phone with someone you're trying to fall in love with, and, like, somehow you're just on the phone. You're just walking around, and the phone's attached to the wall at this point, right? And there's a really long, like, 20-foot cord. The next thing you know, you're wrapped around it, and you're doing something. And you're literally doing the dumbest thing. You're on the phone in complete silence. Because somehow I'm like, I'm with that person, right? And it wasn't hard to just find countless hours to spend just to be on the phone. It wasn't hard to find stuff to talk about. Well, and when you ran out, you just stood on the phone and didn't talk about anything. It wasn't hard to get to know them, was it? Was it hard to talk about plans for your life? No, you just began to talk about your plans. You talked about your dreams. Well, listen, the Father God wants to talk about plans for your life too. He wants you to spend time with Him. He wants to talk to you. He wants to hear from you. He wants you to get to know Him. He wants to spend time with you. You see, the Father God wants to pursue you, and He wants you to pursue Him. I'm going to ask Andrew, are you around here somewhere? We're going to have a worship team come up. As we close this morning, I just want to leave you with this thought out of 1 John chapter 3. It says, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Would you stand with me? I want to read that together. Can we read that together? I want you to just think about it for a second, what that says. Okay, on the count of three, we're going to read that together. One, two, three. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Listen, think about how you feel about your children, maybe how maybe you don't have children, maybe you've got some little people that you're fond of. Think about what you do for them. Think about the love that God has for you. You have anyone in your life where there's some days where you're just like, I don't want to be with you right now, but I do love you, I promise. You know what I'm talking about? Well, here's the thing about the Father God. He not only loves us, but He does want to be with us. Even when we're acting like spoiled brats, He pursues us. And great is the love that He has lavished on us. And that is where our core begins, our identity begins in the Lord, is to understand that there is a Father who's not some distant God, but He desires relationship with us. I mean, we can spend all kinds of time in our life having a debate about the Bible and what a verse means and what it doesn't. But what if you allowed the Lord God, this three-in-one God, to begin to draw you into relationship with Him? How would that change your life? How would it change your life if when you woke up in the morning, really early, before you want to wake up and say, I got to read my Bible today, that instead of uttering that thought in your head, you said to yourself, I got to hang out with my Father this morning and see what He's got to say to me today. And sometimes he says things to you like, you got this, I love you. And sometimes he says things like, you know what? You're in rebellion right now, and you need to get your act together. Or you need to start listening to me. Or you need to start taking my word seriously. Because, you know, the Father disciplines those he loves, and sometimes you open up your Bible for that encouraging word, and you get corrected instead. You have that happen to you, too? Oh, my goodness. And then you go, I don't know, do I really agree with that scripture? And then you start to debate with yourself, right? Instead, set it down and say, Father God, would you draw me in a relationship with you? Would you show me your heart here? And allow the Father to breathe life into you. And when you wake up this morning, I want to challenge you to do something different to tomorrow. Rather than waking up this morning and having your feet hit the ground and say, all right, insert name here. All right, Brad, try to be a good Christian today. Wake up tomorrow and say, okay, Father God, I want to spend this day with you. What do you got for me today? Start that way and see what happens. Start that way. Just simply say, I want to be in relationship with you today and see what happens. See what happens at 1 o'clock when all of a sudden you realize that the Father is with you and you just move to pray. And see what happens when you invite the personal God into your life. Let me pray for you this morning, Lord. As we come to know you more over these next few weeks, I pray that the love of the Father would be lavished on each person here this morning. That just like the prodigal son, that those places where we failure, those places where we've messed up, or we choose to just be consumed with our failure, that we allow you this morning to consume us with your embrace and to show us how much you love us. I pray, Lord God, that the disciplines of life, Lord God, would become about a pursuit, that we would want to know our Father,